What's up, Pontus Pod listeners? You can listen to us every Monday and Thursday on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, or even watch us on YouTube. Now, let's get into the podcast. Hello, everyone, and welcome to episode 28 of the Pontus Pod.
First week of finals done and dusted, Jeremy. What a week it was.
Done and dusted. It's taken a toll on all of us.
It has.
I just want to start off by saying I'm a bit sick in this episode, but you know what? It's finals time. We're G'd up. We pushed through. So if I sound like a bit of a spastic, you know why.
Injury.
Yeah.
Going into current the finals. Injuries.
Lucky we have the week off going into the prelim. So yeah, can avoid that a bit. What a first week of finals. Pretty predictable. We predicted
we got all four games correct.
Spot on for the first four games.
And Let's see. Not to blow air up our own asses, but a lot of videos similar to the one we made about the whole bracket of finals, I did not see a single one get them all right.
Yeah, 100%. I didn't see a single one get all of them right. I know, like, did we pick all the favourites?
GWS favourites? Yeah.
Yeah, they were.
But so it was all the right favourites,
but everyone was throwing up, oh, Saints are going to get it over Giants or
Melbourne over Collingwood.
Yeah, yeah. So picked all that right. Hopefully that prediction doesn't go all the way to the end.
Who do we have this week? We had GWS. Oh, no. We had Port. We had
Port and Melbourne.
And Melbourne win. I reckon that will both happen still.
I think that'll we'll both happen later, as well, maybe. Reckon, but yeah,
We'll see.
I just hope the grand final doesn't end how we said it.
Obviously not.
That'll be devastating for us as Collingwood fans.
Obviously not. Hopefully the Lions don't get the Pies. But hey, both teams have to make it first.
I know.
That's something I want to talk about first of all. Everybody just jumps to conclusions in finals, all right? My two major conclusions I want to speak about is everyone thinks that the teams who win the qualifying finals, because they're in a prelim, just lock them into the
automatic
grand final.
Yeah.
Oh, Collingwood's not going to lose that final, that prelim, and neither is Brisbane. That's going to be the grand final. Many, many times, it doesn't work out like that.
It does fuck with your head a bit, though, because those teams obviously do have a major advantage.
Yeah, I know, but it's happened. It's happened time and time again. Last year, both teams advanced. Sydney beat Melbourne and advanced to prelim and won the prelim. And Geelong won as well.
Geelong beat Collingwood and also things. So ooh,
maybe.
It did happen and my brain doesn't work to go back far enough.
And then my second conclusion is, I feel like everyone, every year now, the second round of finals, semi-final week, always, and it makes sense because the losers of that first round of finals, so in this situation, it was Melbourne and Port Adelaide, everyone is just harping on why they cannot win this semi-final, and because the two teams, GWS and Carlton this year, had to win to advance, and obviously they're in winning form, they've won the last game, everyone's very high on them, and it's interesting to see already this week, everyone speaking about how good GWS and Carlton's chances are, and how likely Port and Melbourne are to go out in straight sets, but you know what, most of the time, the top four teams are the better teams all year. And even though they lost last week, Port Adelaide and Melbourne are going into this game as favourites. And in our predictions, we'll win this week.
Yeah, you're right. It really is nothing logic of just like, oh, they lost last week, so they're going to lose again. Or they're in good form, they're going to win. So
they're versing stronger teams.
Yeah, exactly. And you got to remember too, in the first final, like you said, they are versing stronger teams. So then going up against a weaker team, bottom half of the eight.
Yeah.
Like you can't just count them out straight away just because they lost to a better team.
But let's see what happens. But it is always interesting. There is always usually a twist and turn in the finals. And there hasn't been a major one yet. So let's see.
It's yet to happen so far, but it might possibly. Like two games this week where a major turn could happen very easily. Before we get into this week, let's just go over a bit of last week, go through the games last week, how we saw them. First game was obviously the Collingwood versus Melbourne game. Played out exactly how I thought it was. I think we both predicted this pretty much perfectly.
Pies come out hot.
Pies come out super hot. I'm like really pissed off with myself. I didn't say it on the podcast, but the day before the game, I actually told you that I think, we both actually agreed on it, that first quarter of the game, it'll be something like Collingwood 30 and Melbourne only in single figures. And we got it pretty much exactly correct. And then we also said that throughout the rest of the game, Melbourne's going to be playing catch up, and who knows what could happen then.
But the D's did dominate large parts of the game. They looked like dominant at one stage. As soon as that second quarter hits, in the first quarter, as Collingwood fans, we were saying how happy we were by like nullifying May and Lever's influence. And I reckon May and Lever this week again, massive influence on that game against Carlton. But in the first quarter, the Pies really, they didn't take an intercept mark between the two of them. But then second quarter, they got on top.
May for the Lever, last three quarters, they got on top. Exactly.
And then they
top.
Didn't stop the whole game. And it really challenged Collingwood. And it's what led Melbourne to fight back. But the Pies kept scoring, were very efficient. And yeah, got the job done.
You've probably been hearing this all week. Well, you definitely have. But just the constant harping and going on about how Melbourne won the inside 50s by this much. And they won contested ball by this much. Blah, blah, blah. For me, I don't know. This is just me. But being at the game and watching the quality of inside 50s Melbourne were having were terrible. They were terrible. That mostly sky balls to big packs. And then also, like, all these commentators coming out and saying Melbourne lost the game, Collingwood didn't win it. How is that possible? Like, the game's played in four quarters. Yes, Collingwood did dominate the first quarter. And then you could say Melbourne dominated the final 100%, three quarters.
100%. But Collingwood were more efficient. And you know what? At the end of the day, it doesn't matter. Even if they were efficient inside 50s, if you're not scoring the ball, if the, at the end of the game, your score is lower than the other team, if you win a premiership that way, you win a premiership that way.
I was just about to say, if the grand final is, whatever, Collingwood versus Brisbane, and Brisbane have 70 inside 50s, and Collingwood only have 30. 20.
Yeah, whatever.
And Collingwood still win the game because on 15 out of 20, they scored, and Brisbane only scored on 11 out of their 70. It doesn't matter. The final score is the final score, and that's how it ends.
But I think it's more being brought up in a way of Melbourne are still thereabouts.
Oh, of course they are.
Obviously, everyone's known this whole year. We've been saying the whole year that their forward line is useless, and now, especially without Van Rooyen this week, it becomes very, very testy for him.
Very. Just Melbourne's forwards missing goals cost them big time.
Fritsch, man.
Fritsch.
Fritsch is usually a dead eye as well. I don't know what happened. I actually do not know what happened to him this week.
Well, Fritsch ends on 2-2 with one on the two full. Balls out on the...
Two
out on the fulls. Cozzy also ends on 1-3 with a goal out on the full. Bobby Hill did not miss. He ended on a 3-1.
Three goals, yeah.
Absolute did miss, electric. 3-1. Yeah, I know, but I mean, like, I know. Not that badly.
It was great.
His electric first quarter.
Yeah, his first fine. He set up the Pies. He set up the Pies. His first two goals.
Set him up for victory.
That first tackle on Lever in the goal square wasn't paid holding the ball, but we'll move on.
The Jezza's pick Punters Palace got absolutely destroyed because of Jamie Elliott.
Oh, same.
Fucking
man.
Jamie
same,
Elliott.
Same,
had him
same.
For an anytime goal scorer. It was the easiest leg at $1.11. My multi was steel side bottom 20 plus disposals.
That was good call.
Was paying
good
massive.
Pick. Good
paying
pick.
About $1.60. I knew side bottom's such a finals player. Knew that he would come through. He came through for us very easily. Jordan Dugowie, anytime goal scorer. Love scoring a goal in finals. Got that easily. Jamie Elliott misses two goals
two
in the first
shots.
Quarter. From about 30 out, both of them.
Shit, he gets all the time, man. He eats those up usually.
Eats them up. Ends up fucking us there.
And then he had a horrible game.
Horrible game.
Horrible game. For Elliott's standards, like, horrible game.
I was convinced he was going to be the one subbed out for Ginnivan, but ended up being Darcy Cameron because of sickness.
How about on the, well, like, before anyone listening freaks out, we will get to the big issue from that game later on.
Oh, yeah, we'll get it.
We haven't forgotten. But how about in that game as well? I think who nearly won Melbourne the game in that last quarter, Sparrow and Petrarca, but especially Sparrow was insane.
Dominant.
Man.
Dominant.
Where did they come from? He was crazy.
Well, he's going to have to do that this week as well with Brayshaw being
But he was, like, scary good. He was scary
But Petrarca too. Like, and every
Gorn,
time you saw...
Gorn dominated.
Gorn, obviously. But every time you saw Petrarca get the ball in that last quarter, it was like, he's coming. Like, he was on fire in that last quarter.
But Gorn dominated, and someone last week said rucks are irrelevant.
No, I said in my, whatever it is, prediction review. Video, review yeah. video, preview video, that Gorn was going to be a major factor. He was.
Collingwood.
Luckily, Collingwood played the two talls.
Got the coach's votes.
Wore him down, but...
Yeah.
My free tip for that game was Collingwood win. Obviously, got it done.
Mine was the under 155.5.
Very easy there.
Correct, yeah.
Ended on... I actually saw a bet. Someone put a bet on the alternate under, and it was under 115 at like $56 or something like that, and it came through.
They hit
so
it?
Yeah,
that's
obviously. my margin prediction was Collingwood by 15. Could have been that if they didn't fade off so hard.
Mine was Pies by 6 and they get up by 7. So I was pretty fucking there. On. Pretty on.
And my big call was Tom McDonald, 3+ goals. Ended up kicking 1-1.
Dumb big call.
No, what do you mean? Ended up kicking 1-goal 1 and 1 on the full. So it could have happened.
Come on, man.
Hey, he got the shots up. He just didn't make it.
And you know what? He might get dropped this weekend. He won't.
What?
There's been talks that he was horrible. He was not good. Don't say
he wasn't good, but
don't act like he was good just to protect your tip.
How do you drop him when...
No, he's not going to because of that reason, but there's talks. Have you not heard? Everyone's doubting how shit he was and how he looks like a VFL player. Shit,
but if with Van Rooyen coming out, like, you can't.
You could. Okay. Could check on Grundy.
Fair enough.
Could put Grundy back there, mate. Be the saviour.
What was your big call?
My big call was that the team that loses this game cannot win the premiership, and we got to wait and see, do we not?
Yeah.
I still think...
Very, very safe big call there. That was a very safe big call.
I still think it's hard for them to, but you know what? I can see Melbourne if they get up this week, and then they could be the team to beat Brisbane at the Gabba. But
I said that in the finals predictions, actually. So
we'll wait and see.
We'll wait and see there.
Wait and see.
Next game on the Friday night was the Carlton versus Sydney game. Predicted this game perfectly as well.
Yeah, once again, ended up being what we discussed last week. Swans showed too little too late, and the Blues were the better team all night. Blake Akers had himself a fucking game.
Blake Akers with the two touches on the line. Cottrell played the game of his life. And where are all those people talking about how Patrick Cripps is built for finals? Ooh, he's built for finals, built for finals. Everyone loading him up in multis, 25+, 30+.
That was my free tip. My free tip was Paddy Cripps 30+ at 290. You got like 21?
Yeah, 21. Mills my free tip hit perfectly.
What do you have?
Like I predicted, I said it'll be a goal either way at the end of the game. Ended up being exactly that. Ended up being Carlton by 6. And my free tip was Sydney plus 12.5 at $1.90. Line was way too long. Sydney just had so many opportunities to beat Carlton at the end there.
Yeah, I know.
So many opportunities.
Once again, both games, the Thursday and Friday, the inefficient set shots killed them. Sydney had three set shots in that last 10 minutes that could have got them equal or in the lead, and they just could not do it.
You know the one that stands out for me? It was when Logan McDonald had it on the wing.
Yeah, I know.
And had Will Haywood absolutely bursting through. Ends up kicking to a 2-on-1 Carlton advantage.
Bro.
And cooks them there. I'm telling you, Haywood gets that ball and goes and kicks a goal. It's like...
It's hard for the Blues then. Yeah.
In that game, I wanted to say also, start of the game, obviously crowd was electric. Carlton fans, so happy. They're coming into finals for the first time in 10 years. They're all up and about excited, loud as fuck. Did you notice that getting close to the end of that game, the nerves in the Carlton fans was unreal?
I don't blame them, man. It was scary at the end. Yeah?
Obviously, very scary. But
I actually thought Sydney were going to run over the top when they scored those 3 goals
in
a row.
Same as me.
I thought they were. So I don't blame the Carlton fans.
But the crowd noise decreased and it was just like...
That's what happens.
I know, I understand. But when the camera was panning to the faces, it was like the Collingwood versus Carlton game all over again in 2022. So very... good there. Carlton ended up getting the win. Great for Carlton.
It was a good game. It was a good game. And Harry Mackay still sucks. But we'll get to Harry Mackay later as well.
My prediction for that game was Carlton by 4. Ended up winning by 6. So pretty close there.
Mine was Blues by 20. I thought they'd get it done a bit more comfortably. But the Swans came back in that last.
And my big call, fucking the worst big call of all time, was Harry Mackay to kick 3 goals at $4.
I had the same big call.
He really proved us right on that one, missing 2 goals.
Spud of the fucking yard.
Oh, he's shocking. Absolutely shocking player.
I've actually got a spud of the week this week. I'll get to him later.
One more thing on that game as well. I'm not sure what all these commentators are saying about, and this is going to make me sound like the biggest Carlton hater, but
he's sounding like one.
All these commentators coming out and talking about how, if Carlton lose this semi-final, then it's all right because they've met expectations.
The pressure's off, bro. Like they have no. That's what I had down for the preview when we get to it later. Like it's crazy how content everyone is with one finals win, and now they can get smashed, and everyone will be like, "It's okay, well done, boys."
I don't think everyone's realising that at the start of the year, this was the team that was going to jump into the top 4. This was the team that was going to dominate. They needed to miss out on the 8 by that slim margin last year. They needed all this stuff. They come out, they start terribly, they come on this big run right at the end. I don't care. This isn't a success for them if they lose this game against Melbourne.
The goalposts moved big time. It was
massively.
It was the start of the year, like... They missed finals, but this year they're coming in top four, contending, this, that, whatever. Then they had the bad start to the year, and the goalposts move all the way back to playing finals is a massive success. And now winning a final, anything from here is a bonus. But it's crazy how much it's changed.
Now, listen, it will change for me in my mind now if they do beat Melbourne this week. Oh, and huge. If they lose to Brisbane, then that's fair enough.
Can't blame them.
That's one of the hardest trips. Well, it is the hardest trip in football this year. So if they do that, then be content all you want. But winning one final to Sydney, who Sydney shouldn't have even been in the eight, if it wasn't for that Adelaide fucking umpire call. Like, it's just not good enough for me. When this team was predicted by everyone that they were going to be a top four team.
Look, they got, like, I think everyone's forgetting how much talent they've got on that list, how many top picks they've got on that list. That's why they had the expectation at the start of the year, and they underperformed, but now the underperformance has given them so much leeway, and everyone's just content with mediocrity.
Yeah. People are acting like this is like Carlton or like JWS, who were predicted to be bottom four and have come in and won a final. Like,
exactly.
Very, very different there. Next game was St Kilda versus GWS. My free tip for this game was the under. Definitely didn't happen. Like, who would have expected this game to be a shootout between these two teams?
And mine was, not me. Like, especially St Kilda. Everyone thought that's the way Saints would have tried to win, which was to be defensive, and they didn't do that clearly. And my free tip also definitely didn't win. I had the Saints win. $2.13, and the Saints let me down horrifically.
Giants just a far superior team on the day, like far, far superior. And what I was thinking when I was writing all this up was that St Kilda did good to make it here. This is a team. Is a team where you go, even though they didn't win the final, it's good enough that they made the finals.
Hats off to them.
Start of the season, they had, 15 players that would have been in their best 22 that weren't available through injury, sickness, blah, 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 this and that. Like, good on them. Hats off to them. Great first year under Ross Lyon. Now they rebuild. Now they grab all these, they do all their trades, grab some extra players, go to the draft again, hopefully rebuild. Gets another year under Mitch Owens, Mateus Philippou, all these good young players.
Yeah, it's just the thing of, if you're a Saints fan, you can't be angry. You probably didn't expect this year, and you didn't have that top four expectations going into the season, and you were in the eight all year. Obviously, disappointing way to end against GWS at the G. Like, but what do you do? GWS were the better team, but I think everyone is getting too carried away with GWS a little bit. I'll get to that later, it is a bit disappointing how they weren't even in for a fight most of the game.
No, not at all. Josh Kelly with the performance of the final series so far, 27 disposals, 2 goals, 1.
It was crazy.
Absolutely insane. He was everywhere on the ground, absolutely killed it the whole entire game.
For real.
Giants have to be one of the biggest smokies in this final series for me.
I'll get to it later, but I just feel like we're forgetting that they versus St Kilda. They're a good team, they're playing good footy, and they've won 11 games away, blah, blah, blah. And it's an amazing year, amazing story, but I still think that they are not really contenders. If they get to a grand final, I will be shocked. I don't even think they'll win this week. But I don't know. I feel like, because look, they do have a lot of good players. They still got your Tom Green, Toby Green, Whitfield, Kelly, Cogs comes back this week. Hogan's a good player. Taylor's a good defender. So they've got a good list and they've got good players. But I still think it's not to the extent where they're actually contending. Like, a lot of people have jumped the gun after one win against St Kilda in a final.
Listen, I can understand what you're saying, but GWS this year really mimics for me a lot of Collingwood last year, where come into the season with very low expectations, go on a great run to finish off the end of the year, which both teams did, and then in finals, they have that much belief in themselves. Now, this mantra of anytime, anywhere, they have that much belief in themselves. I think that could be a scary prospect for teams like Port Adelaide this week, maybe Collingwood next week. Like, very, very scary.
It's scary. And I would not be surprised if it happened. But for now, I'm not going to jump the gun. I still think they're not contending for the flag right now.
My margin for this game was GWS by 10. They obviously win by more than that.
What was the margin in the end, you know?
20-something.
Yeah, they had a good win. I obviously had the Saints win, and I had 25 points. But fuck me, man. Like, I knew going into last week.
24 like, points. 24 so you, points. If it was the opposite, you would have got close.
Yeah, there you go. 50-point turnaround. But I knew going into last week that the GWS win everywhere, and they've got the 11 games now away win at different venues, whatever, whatever. But I just thought the Saints would just be better, but they just weren't. They simply weren't.
My big call for that game was Toby Green to have 2 goals and 20 disposals. Ended on 1 goal to 19 disposals. So as close as you can get, pretty much.
That's pretty good. My big call was not a good one. I had Max King to score 5 goals. What do you end on? Do you
three, know? I think, maybe.
Three? Oh, not bad. Not all right, King, you're all right. But I thought the Saints would win, so I thought he'd have a massive day.
And the final game of the first round was the Lions versus Port game. Holy shit, was I right about this one as well. My free tip was Brisbane minus 14 and a half at $1.90. I said, I just knew Brisbane would absolutely dominate this game. Port stood no chance. And then especially when your players like Trent McKenzie go down with a semi-injury, the Dylan Williams and the interchange debacle where they sub off Darcy Byrne-Jones right after he kicks a goal.
Yep.
And then Dylan Williams gets injured just as soon as Boat gets subbed on. It's just an absolute mess.
Crazy. No way. I'm going to make a big call right now before anything happens. No way the D's or Blues beat this team at the Gabba.
I know
I just said Melbourne have a chance, but I still think at the Gabba it's impossible. And then watch the MCG curse fucking be hounded on that whole grand final week.
Yeah. Like, Lions just looked like they were boys playing against men, honestly. Yep. They dominated them in every facet of the game. Obviously, you're going to give some of that to being at the Gabba, home ground advantage.
I still just think they're the best team in it, regardless.
I think they are the best team in it at the moment.
Yep.
Form-wise, and just the way that they've been playing, they're the best team in the league.
I agree. And Danaher, huge. And my X-Factor player, last week we named X-Factor players, Cam Rayner. That X-Factor, like him playing like that, if he has a final series like that, he legit takes him to a premiership.
That is a player built for finals. And when people say players built for finals, a lot of these people say like contested bulls in the midfield. My built for finals players are
Petrarca,
Cam Rayner, Degoe.
They're all contested bulls. What are you on about?
No, but I'm saying forward that can get you 25 and also kick 2 goals in a game. Like, what did Rayner end on? I think it was like four goals, 16. I don't
know. Yeah, something like that.
4 goals, 16 was crazy. In a final is insane.
And he was my X Factor player last week. I knew he was destined for thing. I just knew it. And I also wanted to say, Port looked very wounded and vulnerable. Like, so I think it was a good win for Brisbane, but it just clearly wasn't Port's day. And even when the scoreline was tightening up, I still think they never looked like a chance.
That was like we always say this, but when you know a team's going to win from the start.
Yeah.
Like, a team is dominating from the start. Even if Port got close enough to him, it was always going to be Brisbane at the end of it.
It looked at the whole game. And hopefully this week for Port, they don't look so vulnerable and wounded, because that is when I can see GWS striking. And once again, if GWS win this week against a Port that looks how they did last week, I still think it's more GWS getting lucky. I don't know, but we'll see.
I don't know. My margin for that game was Brisbane by 28, so got very, very close there.
Mine was Brisbane by 8. So,
and
not,
big
not
call
as close.
Was Zach Bailey to have 20 and a goal, didn't even get close.
My big call was the winner walks into grand final day, which, once again, we got to see.
Yeah, we got to see
but,
as well.
But
fuck, very soft calls by you.
But you know what? I'll back in Brisbane to make the granny, and I'll back in Melbourne to not have a chance to win the premiership. So I'm happy with it.
All right, boys, we're going to take a little break from our sponsor, punterspass.com, get into this week's topics, and then review the 2 games coming up this week.
Ooh, yeah.
What's up, Punters Pod listeners? This podcast is sponsored by punterspass.com, a site where you can sell and buy sports tips online for free. All you got to do is register for an account, go to the Connect Your Account tab, connect your bank account, you get your pay straight through there. You get paid out daily from your subscribers. You get to set whatever monthly fee you want to set. It's the best sports punting site on the web. Boys, you got to get on it. We make heaps of money through this, and you can too. Easiest side hustle ever. Just sell your sports tips online for free, or subscribe to us at JezzaPicks and Ethan Tips. Go search us up. Go get on it. Thanks, and let's get back into the show.
Okay. We back, and let's get into some of the big, big topics from this week. A lot of controversy this week, especially about one man from the Collingwood Football Club, Jeremy, Brayden Maynard.
Obviously, we're going to talk about this. Was the biggest story by far this whole week. Like, you'd forgotten everyone had played a first final, because this is all anyone was talking about throughout this whole week.
It was massive.
Obviously, at the time that we are recording, Brayden Maynard is off completely. AFL can't appeal it because it is Wednesday night right now, and they had up to lunchtime today to do it. So That's completely out the window there. Just the most blown up thing out of proportion ever.
That's what I had to, I said, the most overreaction and hysteria about something that, like, at the end of the day, wasn't even that bad.
Massive win for the AFL, unless you're not a Collingwood fan or you hate Brayden Maynard.
I was going to say, like, Pies haters wanted to give him a life sentence and Pies fans were defending him for their life. And it was just like, either way, it was just like, shouldn't have been this much emphasis on one incident.
It really became like just fans going against fans.
Yeah.
Like there was, all logic was thrown out the window. All this shit brought up about emotion and blah, 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 yeah, all this shit. Like, we acted like
Brayshaw died.
Yeah, and footy as an industry wants to be so professional, so this, so that. But then when shit like this comes up, they want to bring in emotion and they want to bring in the family and people who is related to and this and that.
And the top commentators are clearly, like, I don't care if you're on which side of the coin you're on, you could clearly see people who were in the camp of Melbourne and the camp of Collingwood, like public media commentators that shouldn't be that biased, clearly choosing a side.
I got to give everyone respect because most commentators said that Maynard wasn't in the wrong. It was a footy act, blah, blah, blah. But some commentators like Gary Lyon went way too far.
But obviously clearly why.
Yeah, he's got Melbourne connections, blah, blah, blah.
James, and
he's
very Brayshaw, close clearly.
To the Brayshaw family, same as James Brayshaw. But like bringing up shit like Danny Frawley and the family really wants Maynard to get suspended. Like, I'm sorry, but what is that going to do? Like, I understand the concussion is a massive topic in footy at the moment and we're going through all these lawsuits, blah, 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 shit like that. But Maynard getting suspended for 3 weeks isn't going to do anything to that.
Yep.
It's a footy act completely. He went for the smother. I don't get how people were saying that, like, he preempted putting the shoulder into Brayshaw's head.
No. But look, to be honest, just thank fuck it's done. And clearly was legal and clearly was an accident and clearly he wasn't going for his head, but I just don't even understand the whole story of the flowers and the vase. Like, that was stupid as well. But just thank fuck it's over. Justice prevails. Bruz plays in a prelim. Brayshaw will play in a prelim if Melbourne make it.
100%. 100%.
We'll laugh. And you know what? That's it. I'm calling it. Surprise spud of the week.
I know who you're going to say.
The spud of the week this week, Hamish Brayshaw.
Fucking massively.
Bro, I know it's your brother. That's my brother. And if he got concussed, I would be upset and angry as well. Correct. But you're a former AFL player, you're a grown man, and you're bringing up arguments like you're some 12-year-old on the playground. Like, what do you mean the AFL wants Collingwood to win the premiership? That is the spuddest call I've ever heard in my life. You just get a grip, bro. Realize that it's not some little game. It's a tribunal. This shit happens. And you're playing footy. You might get hit. And he wears a helmet because he knows it's a risk. So how about we suck it up, toughen up. I'm surprised anyone bet Harry Mackay for spud of the week this week. But Hamish Brayshaw, you are the spud of the week. And that was the dumbest thing I've ever heard in my life.
Just on that as well, it's not even being a spud. It's just being a nuffy. Like, that shit, like 50-year-olds in AFL fan pages argue with each other. Man. Like, oh, they just, AFL just want Collingwood to win the flag.
Like, that's the AFL gives a fuck. They make their money either way.
No, they make their money either way. And whatever, people are going to talk about crowd sizes and all this shit. You think the MCG isn't going to be packed no matter who's playing on the grand final day?
Exactly, man.
Like, it's ridiculous. He just loses all credibility if he ever had any in being a footy commentator. It's just...
It's not a commentator.
But I mean, just commenting on the game of AFL. No. Just loses all credibility that he had or didn't have. Just looks like an absolute nuffy. Just shit more on supporters, say.
Spud of my week. Spud of the week.
Spud there.
Surprise Harry didn't get it this week. He was front running easily. His award, the Harry Mackay spot of the year. But Hamish Brayshaw pips him.
Now, speaking about Harry Mackay, player you just mentioned, I want to bring up something, and nobody in the media would ever come out with this because we're all about protecting players, blah, blah, blah. But we do it a little different here, and I think that I've noticed something that no one else will say, but maybe I'm just a conspiracy theorist, maybe I'm not. Now, it's the end of the third quarter, and Harry Mackay has had an absolute stinker, yeah?
Horrific.
He's missed two goals in the game already from about 10 metres out.
In the goal square.
One running into goals, hits the post. The other about 15 metres out, set shot right in front, misses. Yeah. The ball heads inside Carlton's forward 50 and Harry Mackay gets in a 2-on-1, tries to spoil the ball, whatever, whatever. Now, the camera pans away and you can see a little tumble on the floor between all players. Camera pans away to the play and then pans back to Mackay on the floor.
Rolling.
Huddled up, rolling around. Yeah. Now, extremely, extremely innocuous thing that happened there. Like,
yeah.
And I went through the footage and I looked through it and I saw that Harry Mackay's head did not hit any part of anyone at any time. Now, people will say, oh, an arm was in the way and you didn't see it. There was never enough force in any of that to be concussed. Now, this is where my conspiracy comes from.
This is outrageous.
Through. I truly believe that Harry had realized that Carlton was looking like they were about to win and they were going to progress and move on into the next week. And I truly think the goal-kicking demons have gotten that bad inside his head that he said, I need an out here.
So you think he's faked this concussion?
I think maybe not faked. Well, yes, I think he's faked the concussion.
Make your call, buddy, make your call.
Okay, yeah, I'm going to stick by it. I think he's faked this concussion because he's that worried that Carlton are going to progress. He's going to have goal-kicking woes and he's going to end up losing a final for Carlton. Notice how not a single person has talked about Harry Mackay's bad goal-kicking, those two horrific misses at goal.
No.
Nobody has mentioned it at all. And why is that? Because he went off with concussion and everyone's thing. It's forgotten about.
Look, if I'm a Carlton supporter, I'm probably a little bit happy.
Same as me.
As we discussed a few weeks ago on the podcast, they're probably better off without him. But a lot of Carlton fans came for our necks saying, no way, we're better without him. We need Harry. But what has he done since he came back? That Gold Coast game he came back, what has he done?
Nothing at all.
And for somebody who makes so many excuses, speaking on his podcast about how, oh, the balls are too pointy, that's why I miss my shots, whatever. Your conspiracy sounds a bit stupid, but might be true.
Now,
if it's true to any player, it's true to Harry Mackay.
Now, tell me this too. Imagine Sydney do complete their run. Imagine Carlton lose that game by like 4 points.
Yeah, yeah, I know.
And he's horrific. Missed two crucial goals.
That were gimmies.
Gimme goals.
True.
Any player in the AFL would score those.
True. Any Oz kicker would score those.
The demons have gotten that bad in his head that he just wanted an out and found the out, got out of it. Now he's not playing this week. We'll see what happens
I still probably would lean to your conspiracies is a bit far-fetched.
I don't know.
But we'll see. But
I don't believe it.
I'll give him his credit. He was pretty good up the ground. But when he gets within those goals, you can just see his face.
Yeah,
I feel like his face just changes and he's just nervous and pressure. And I don't know. He just looks dumbfounded.
You know that second goal he missed, yeah?
Yeah.
I saw him take the mark and then I was watching the TV, so then I go, oh, he's marked it fucking 15 metres out right in front.
Goal.
I went to the kitchen to go grab something to eat. I heard someone scream. I turn around, look at the TV again. He's hit the post from fucking 15 metres out, like directly in front.
It's so Harry Mackay, man.
It's just so innocent. This is like...
How did this man win the Coleman?
This is Ben Simmons free throw syndrome. It actually is.
That's like, good, it's true.
He's that far in his head that it's not even funny.
Yeah, right. It's exactly Ben Simmons. That's very good. But, yeah, spud of the year, Harry Mackay.
Spud of everything, fuck me. Let's get into the finals preview. Free tips, all that good shit. Like always, boys, punterspalace.com. Subscribe to Jezza Picks, Ethan Tips. There's only 5 more games of AFL left.
Yeah, that's it.
Then we're going to hit the NFL hard. Ooh. And then the NBA, where we're going to give you premium bets every single day. Same game multis, all that good shit. NBA, we absolutely killed it last year, so... Hop on with us. You can hop on now, get the last bit of our footy and NFL, or you can hop on in a couple months and get all our NBA. But get on, Jezza Picks, Ethan Tips. Let's get into these games.
For sure. The first game, of course, will be massive 92,000 again, we'd say, at the MCG. Melbourne versus Carlton.
I'm sorry, Carlton fans, but I think this is where the fairy tale ends. I can't see Melbourne getting bounced in straight sets for the second year in a row.
It's hard to see it happening, but if there ever is a time for Carlton to get them, I think it is this week. Everything's going against Melbourne. You lose Van Rooyen, you lose Brayshaw, unfortunately. You're in a position where you played decent last week, but that forward line just isn't kicking, and I can't see many solutions this week for them, for that forward line to work. And Carlton have got the confidence over them from a few weeks ago, and would like their chances in this game.
On that point there, I can understand how Carlton beat Melbourne, beat in quotations, with that score review right at the end of that Carlton-Melbourne game just a couple of rounds ago. This is massively different. This is different. Finals. Melbourne immaculate finals team.
Last year straight sets. What do you mean?
No, but I'm saying, like, they've got a shit ton more experience than Carlton have.
So did Sydney last week. That you can't always go by that.
Fair enough. I just think that Melbourne don't fuck around in this game at all.
I agree.
Like everyone has said, Melbourne in all facets of the game should have been in Collingwood for last week if it wasn't for Collingwood's immaculate defense. I think Carlton's defense lacks a bit compared to Collingwood's.
Yep.
For me, Cozzy doesn't go one goal, three. Fritch doesn't miss two goals and have one go out on the full. Like, I just can't see it.
I also, in my free tip, as you'll hear later, I still do think Melbourne will win. But I'm just saying they are vulnerable. If Carlton are to get them, it will be this week. They couldn't have got Melbourne on a better week with even Gorn's toe and everything happening and them sooking the fucking
house down
with Maynard. It is a time where Carlton could push him. But then again, the Blues do lose Mackay, whether you think that's good or bad.
Jack Martin
is a bigger loss.
That's the massive loss for him.
Bigger loss.
He has been absolutely rock solid for them in these past few rounds.
Even at the end of the game, went behind the ball.
Yeah, possibly one of their most important players. Like, even last game when Charlie didn't have that big of an influence, seemed like Jack Martin's pressure and just he was everywhere. Martin was everywhere.
Yeah, he was. He was good. And I don't know if the thing is with this game, like we said before and earlier, the D's have immense pressure on this game. And for Carlton, it's a bit of a free hit. They can just go out there, try to win the game. And if they don't win, everyone's content. All their fans are proud. And they've basically got nothing to lose.
I actually had that exact thing written down about pressure. And what I think is this pressure can go either way.
Yep.
This pressure can get way too much for Melbourne and weigh on them so heavily that they come out unfocused. Or this pressure can be what fuels them and is like, we need to win this game no matter what. We have to push as hard as we can, be laser focused in this game, end up getting the win. Because I saw some crazy stats. Like the last time this happened where a top four team has gone out in straight sets, I don't think it's ever happened. Two years in a row. I don't think it's ever happened. So that's insane.
It is pressure.
Like massive pressure there. I think Tom De Koning has a massive game this game.
Oh, Tom De Koning.
I think Tom De Koning has a massive game.
Well, last time they versus Melbourne, De Koning and Pitonet did beat up on Gorn.
Well, I'm not even talking about in the ruck. I'm saying in the forward line.
Yeah, he was good last week as well, De Koning.
I think Lever and May are going to have to double team Charlie. Now with Martin out, takes another tall-ish player out. Like, you would say Lever or May, one of them would have gone to Jack Martin.
No way.
Okay, then who then?
I don't know, but it's not May or Lever.
Okay, say one goes to Kurnow. Who would the other go to?
Mackay, if he was playing. I know,
I'm saying if Mackay wasn't playing.
But they're both not playing. Martin and Mackay are not playing.
If only Mackay
was
out.
Playing. I don't know. They'd go to whoever's resting forward, either Pitonet or De Koning.
Whatever. Okay. You don't think like Joel Smith could have handled that?
Joel Smith's playing forward.
No, he played back. For
last
some,
week? No, he did.
He played
no,
back for some.
I was at the ground.
Me anyway. Too.
Bro, all right, go on.
He was moving back and forth.
I thought he was forward the whole game, to be honest.
No, you're tripping.
All right.
He was moving back and forth. Anyway, what was I saying? Yeah, Tom De Koning has a massive game this game. I think he absolutely dominates in the forward line, especially if they are going to double team Charlie Kurnow.
Double team Charlie, brother.
Why? So reckon, teams have been doing it the whole year. What are you saying?
So you reckon they're going to leave De Koning free and just go to one of them?
No, you know what I mean by double team.
All right, go on.
You think in the air, by yes, double
okay,
team, I mean.
Yes, yes, okay.
So what are you saying?
My bad, go on.
Anyway, Jack, like I said, Jack Martin is a huge loss. Been so important for them for the last few weeks, especially in that first final. Like you said, when he went back.
Yep.
Just think De Koning has a massive game.
De Koning fan, you are a De Koning fan.
Yeah, okay.
yeah, I do not see Melbourne losing this game just based off the fact that they need to take care of business. We've harped on it right now. They need to win this game. They can't go out straight sets 2 years in a row, and they will win this game. That's why my free tip is the D's minus 6.5 at $1.90. Small line, one goal. They can get it done, I think, even if it's a close game. I still think they'll cover that goal in a little bit.
Yeah, this line is way too small for me. My free tip is also going to be Melbourne at minus 6.5 at $1.90. Really, really love that line. I think that line's way too small. And I do think Melbourne end up getting the job done. I also really, really, really like, and this isn't a big call, this is just what I really like. My margin for this game is Melbourne by 32. I really, really like Melbourne 25 plus at $3.20.
Well, that applies to me because my margin is Melbourne by 28. I still think they will get it done and run over the top in the end.
And my big call, which maybe you would have guessed it from my little spiel there.
De Koning scores 5.
No. Big call, and this is a very, very big call. Charlie Kurnow scores zero goals.
Look at this. May and Lever dominate the air. Kurnow goes goalless.
Bro, I do.
But not double teaming him. They just
in
dominate.
In the air.
Yeah, right.
Okay.
Big call for both of us is Charlie Kurnow goes goalless. Does not score a goal.
That's insane that we had the same
thing. That's crazy.
Like, that is my genuine call. Same. Charlie Kurnow scores zero goals. And also, I added a little Tom De Koning scores three. Oh, if you want to get Tom De Koning for 3 goals, he's paying a massive $18.
Fuck, you're an idiot.
$18. But nah. Get on that, lads.
I think Charlie, 0 goals this game.
Yeah. Probably, I really do think it.
He'll probably end up scoring 5 and making a mockery out of us, and Carlton fans will be fucking wishing us death, but we'll see.
And the next game and final game of this finals round is
games, man.
Port Adelaide versus the GWS Giants.
Once again, the winning team from the first final is chilling, has a free hit, which is GWS this game. And for Port, a lot of pressure to not go out straight sets at Adelaide Oval this week. Especially because of the whole backing in Ken. You hate to go out straight sets after the year you've had. Oh. They're vulnerable as well because of the injuries. They looked wounded last week. And GWS have a lot of hype and are playing great footy. You heard Tom Green. They want all the smoke, brother. They want all the fucking smoke. But to overlook Port at home is outrageous to me. Considering no one has beaten the Lions at the Gabba. And GWS just bet Port, Saints I don't really rate. So we'll have to see.
Just on that Ken Hinckley thing, how much of an embarrassment would it be for them if they go out in straight sets?
Fucking, it'd
and be especially
pretty huge.
How they re-signed Ken when they went on that like 4 or 5 game losing streak, and then won one game, and then they're like, okay, this is our chance to re-sign him.
They shouldn't have played around. They should have just signed him when they were in cracking.
No,
form.
They should have just let it run all the way through. Yeah. I think they should have let it run all
anyway,
the way through.
You never win with that.
Yeah, you can, because the pressure's constantly on him right to the end. Like, I know injuries have hindered.
So you really think that's why they're losing games?
No. I'm just saying it'll look very stupid for them if they go out.
It will.
That's the whole knock on Ken, that in September they never get it done. They always fade to the end of the season.
No, you're right.
And if they end up going out in stress, it's a massive blemish for them. Unlike the other game, I think this one's going to be super tight the whole way through.
See, I disagree.
I think this is going to be an absolute shootout.
I can, but anyway.
No chance. Absolutely loved what GWS did last week, even though it was against a weak opponent in St Kilda. I just haven't rated Port Adelaide in these past couple rounds and weeks at all.
To be honest, since probably... Because at one stage of the season, if you remember, it was Collingwood Port locked in for top two.
Yep.
Since they dropped off and lost that game to Collingwood in Adelaide Oval, and then they lost to Carlton as well, and Marvel got smashed by them, they have looked really off, and they haven't really looked like that team who went on the 13-game win streak this year.
Not at all. Those injuries in the back line are really starting to scare me. They're starting to stack up. It's like...
They got no one now.
Alia is like the solo man down there.
They got no one.
That's going to have to take on Danaher... Hipwood, McInerney when he goes back there.
Who are you talking about? They're not versing Brisbane. They're versing GWS, you idiot. He'll have to defend Hogan.
Boys, I'm sick, sorry.
Give me a break. Jeez,
Hogan.
Your finals form's ridiculous.
Hogan and Riccardi. I think one of them gets off massively in this game. And yeah, so like that's what I think. I saw Brisbane in my run sheet thing. What I was going to say is so many forwards dominated for Brisbane last week that it's going to be very scary for Port Adelaide, especially with their lack of defense.
It is.
I think you throw Darcy Byrne-Jones back in the back line just for this game at least. Yeah. I know he's succeeded in the forward line, but throw him back for this game, put him on a Binger Daniels, put him on a Toby Bedford just to try and quell their influence a bit.
He's not really the most lockdown defender. He's more
lockdown,
offensive.
But just to play a run with role or something like that. But anyway. Fucking Brett Daniels gets up the ground like crazy. He goes from the D50 to the forward 50 and
Brent.
Nothing.
Brent's not Brett. But for me, Giants are a scary team. I agree with everything you're saying. And I love their away record and all the smoke. Look, if you win Tom Green, send me a personal message saying you want my smoke as well. But at the Adelaide Oval, the Port fans, massive advantage. Regardless, they're a good team. They've been a good team all year. They've dropped off form Port, but I still think they get the game won. And my free tip is a bit out there, but I think Connor Rosie, 30-plus disposals at $2.40. He's the forgotten man a bit now because Butters has taken all the hype kind of from Rosie. And I think Rosie has a massive game at home and gets them the win into a prelim against the Pies.
My free tip for this game is going to be over 175.5 at $1.90. Very big line there, but I think this is going to be an absolute shootout. My margin is going to be GWS by 3 points.
So you think GWS win?
I think they just win.
Mine is Port by 16 points. I think Port win.
And my big call, and if we have the same big call, that's insane because I don't know how we would both pick this. My big call for this game is going to be that this game ends in a draw and goes to extra time.
That's definitely not my big call.
This game ends in a draw and goes to extra time. That's what I feel like will happen in this game.
That's not my big call.
I feel like this is like that Port versus West Coast game many years ago. I feel like
it's awesome.
A tight game the whole way through. They go into extra time. Put it down, boys. I don't know what a draw is paying, but put it down.
Fuck, if this happens, we'll come back to this and be amazed. My big call, pretty simple big call, but I do think Port win. I do think Port are the better team, and I think Todd Marshall will score 4+ goals and will redeem himself from last week's pretty poor game for his standards.
Draw's paying $41, boys. Get on it.
The draw's always paying $41. If the draw happens, cool.
We're going to take another little break from our sponsor, punterspalace.com, and then get into Guess the Player and the Emoji Game.
What's up, Punters Pod listeners? This podcast is sponsored by punterspalace.com, a site where you can sell and buy sports tips online for free. All you got to do is register for an account, go to the Connect Your Account tab, connect your bank account, you get your pay straight through there, you get paid out daily from your subscribers, you get to set whatever monthly fee you want to set. It's the best sports punting site on the web. Boys, you got to get on it. We make heaps of money through this, and you can too. Easiest side hustle ever, just sell your sports tips online for free or subscribe to us at JezzaPix and Ethan Tips. Go search us up, go get on it. Thanks, and let's get back into the show.
All right, boys, we're back, and we are going to do maybe a bit of a forgotten segment throwback. On the Punters Pod, but throwback. A bit of a throwback. We're going to do a Guess the Player just to bring us into this second week of finals. Ooh. Ethan's guessing this one. I've got the player in mind. Like always, has to be a current player. 10 questions. You got to guess on the 10th question.
Yep.
Go ahead. What is your first question?
Haven't done one of these for a while. My first question is... Is this player playing in the final series?
No, he's not playing in the final series.
All right. So I got 10 teams to go from now.
Yeah,
cheers.
Very bad question.
Is this player's team Victorian?
Yes, this player's team is Victorian.
Okay. Is this player's team Richmond?
No.
How many is that? Questions?
Three.
Okay. Oh, fuck. I'm going to ruin all my questions here. Is this player's team Hawthorn?
No.
Fuck, I'm going to burn all my questions. North Melbourne?
No.
Fuck my life. Fuck, so I got to get the team and then the player in 5 questions. This is a rabble. Okay. Is this player's team... I don't even know who else was in the thing. Did I say Richmond, Hawthorn, North? Yeah.
Yeah.
Is this player's team... I fucking lost it.
Come on, bro. There's so many Victorians teams.
I know, that's the problem. Is this player's team Bulldogs?
No.
Fuck off, man.
You're going to waste all your questions.
Jeez, what else can I ask? Fuck's sake.
Do I give you the team?
Give me the team and that burns a question.
Okay. That burns a question? Yeah. All right. Now, this will be your 7th question.
7th question.
Team is Geelong.
Geelong.
So you got Geelong. You got 2 guesses to guess the player.
If I narrow this down to a Geelong player and guess who it is, give me my fucking flowers, all right? Is this player... A midfielder?
No.
Fuck's sake. So do I have to guess now?
No, you got one more question okay. And then you guess.
Is this player a forward?
Yes.
Okay, so all my information I have is a Geelong forward.
And I got nothing else.
And yeah. I got to guess the player. So I got a Geelong forward, okay.
Obviously, for us, if you get this. Really? This will be the greatest comeback of all time.
Fuck me, man. I need to catch up. It's finals time.
You're
not going to
get it,
up.
I'm telling you.
It's not going to be grind. All right, let me run through my.
No, thoughts. I'm not doing this.
Okay,
run through your thoughts, but I'm not showing face.
It's not going to be Grind Myers, all right? Not going to be Ollie Henry. It's too predictable. Hawkins, no. Jezza Cameron, no. Brad Close is interesting to me. I'm thinking Brad Close. Also interesting to me. Fuck it. Give me Brad. Is it Brad Close?
No.
Oh, who is it?
Tyson Stengel.
Oh, Stengel. And then every other cunt, man.
You know
fuck.
What? All you needed was one more question just to go a small forward. And you would have got it so
fuck.
Easy.
Fuck. That's all right. Fuck. I've been defeated there. That's horrible. That's why we stopped doing the segment.
Yeah,
because
yeah,
I couldn't get it. Fucking that, oh, rattled.
All right, and now this is always a bit scary when we're playing the emoji game, and Ethan's made up the emojis.
They're good this week.
Always scary, but since the Warner incident that everyone knows about. But emoji game, let's get it started.
Let's go. Wait. So I want to give credits to Kurt on this one because Kurt sent this through. All right.
Yeah.
I like these emojis, and Kurt sent this one through. All right. So shout out Kurt. Your first emojis are, remember to explain them.
A van, a kangaroo, and a dollar. Oh, Van Ruin.
Van Ruin.
That's a yen. That's exactly. A yen. Okay, good. That's
it's
so great. Easy.
It's good by Kurt. It's
that's a very off. Easy.
That easy. We'll start off light.
Thanks, Kurt, for that.
We'll get
Kurt
more
gave
into
me a
it.
Little dub there.
We'll get more into it. This one, all right? This one, I feel like I might get roasted for this one, but I think
he's definitely going to get roasted.
I think it's pretty good, all right? I think this one is gettable. Just think about it. Think a bit obscure.
Oh, here we go.
This is your next emoji.
This is going to be one that the emoji has nothing to do with
these
the
meme. Are your next emojis.
Okay. I got a dog and a swan.
A dog and a swan.
Wolf, swan. Like, this is so...
Nah, it's
dog,
it's,
swan.
It's easy, cuz. Sorry.
Am I on the bark? Swan. Does the dog have the word dog in
the
it?
The dog is not dog. Okay, the dog so is a... You got to think about the dog.
Hound.
No.
Bark.
Type of dog is your clue,
type
right?
Of dog.
Type of dog. Easy. Think about it then. Connect the words.
Something swan. So breed of dog and swan.
Come on. You just said the answer. Everyone's looking at you.
Breed of dog and swan.
Oh, you keep saying
breed
it.
Breed swan.
No.
Dog swan.
You're saying one of the words.
Breed of dog. Breed. Is the word breed?
No. The second emoji is correct.
Swan. Yes. No fucking shit. The second emoji swan.
Now think of a dog and then think of a swan.
Swan.
Think of a swan. What's a swan in the AFL ever? You come on, man.
What is a swan in the AFL?
Yes.
Sydney.
Who is a swan? Who is a swan?
Nick Blakey. I don't know. I don't know what you're saying.
Swan. Think about it, bro.
Oh, Dane Swan.
Dane Swan.
That is so
bad.
That is ridiculously
bad. Great Dane. You see a dog. I got a dog that looked like a Great Dane.
That looks nuts. Do you know what a Great Dane looks
not
like?
Not really, but we'll take it.
Oh my God.
That's all like Dane
roast
Swan.
Him for that
Dane
as well.
Swan.
That is terrible.
That's not that bad.
How am I meant to get the breed of dog from a
emoji? Because I gave you the clue. You know what? That's on you. After I said type of dog, I'm telling you, after I gave the clue type of dog, everyone else said, yeah, all right, Dane Swan. It might be shit, but I can get Dane Swan.
Give me the next one. Give me the next one.
Hey, this one's not good either. This one's not good either,
you're
right?
Shocking at doing these.
Okay. This one. Think about it obscurely again. Let's go. Your next emojis. Yeah. Read them out.
I got a lion, an E, and a volleyball.
Wow, that's good. That's a good start. Come
Lionel.
On.
Lionel.
No.
Grandmize.
No.
Lion.
What's a lion do?
Roar.
Okay.
Rory.
Ooh, this is good. Well done, man.
Yeah, okay. You gave it to me. But Rory Ball. Rory Sloan.
No.
Rory Atkins.
No.
Rory Lob. Because you lob a volleyball.
There you go, man. Not bad. Not bad. That was all right.
I think one was okay.
The Dane Swan one, everyone's getting that.
I'd love to see the comments I can't wait to see the comments
bro,
on that.
Great Dane.
I guess so.
You're saying type of dog swan. Dane Swan. Think
yeah,
about
you
it.
You kept telling me, oh, you're saying the word.
Yeah, it's
I thought it was like breed something.
No, man. Anyway.
Breed Daniels.
Fucking.
Breed Daniels. All right. That'll finish us off there, boys. Like always, punterspalace.com. Get on. Subscribe. Jezza Picks, Ethan Tips. Go follow us on Instagram, TikTok, all that good shit. We're going to be posting all our clips there. And yeah, enjoy the final series, boys.
Oh, big week. Two games this week.
If your team's playing, hope they win. And let's get one step closer to that grand final.
Ooh, big day, big day. Thanks for listening. Subscribe, like, share, download. Peace, prosperity, and love. Yeah, yeah.